What do you know about the Native American population? On today's Good News with Judy and Imani, you're going to hear some good news about what God's doing in a special people that were here before the Americans came. I'm Judy Redlick. Imani's not with me on this show, but we are right here with Good News with Judy and Imani. So please stay tuned, won't you? We got a really cool show for you today. How much do you know about your Native American brothers and sisters? Wait till you hear some facts, some statistics, how you can be a better neighbor to them, and how God is using Christians all over the world to see them grow in Christ, and how God is using this population in our nation, the land of the free. Well, my guests are Ivan and Linda Doxtator. Welcome to Good News with Judy and Imani.
Thank you.
Now, First Nation Restoration Ministries, what is that all about?
Well, I don't know how much time we have, but...
3 hours and 20 minutes. No, we have...
it's about basically First Nations relates to Native American. You know, there's terminology different people use. They use Indian and all these other terms, and there are different preferences that. But First Nations means relate to the first people that were here. Restoration means, you know, the Lord comes to bring restoration and healing. And so that's basically what we do with different populations, although one of our primary focuses is First Nations populations. You know, it also encompasses the body of Christ across the country, the continent. So, you know, it's about restoration and healing for God's people so they can be all that God created them to be.
Talk about some of the statistics of our Native American population across the nation.
Well, you know, you have groups in the United States and Canada. In the United States, there's approximately 565 different federally recognized tribes.
565, amazing.
Across the United States, and there's over 600 bands in Canada. And all of these tribes have their own language and culture that, you know, shape how they function and operate. So statistic-wise, you know, Native America has one of the highest suicide rates, sometimes the national average in specific communities. There's immense impoverishment, you know, where the levels are, like in Montana, the unemployment rate among Native peoples upwards of 50% across the board. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's a tremendous sense of not only restoring people spiritually and psychologically, but financially, you know, developing economic development within these groups so that, you know, they can have businesses and they can function within their own communities. So, you know, the restoration issue is a major, it has these different, you know, different perspectives.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Now, how did you and Linda meet, and what are your affiliations to the Indians? let's let Linda tell that story.
Let her go first.
It wasn't love at first sight. we met in the field, so to speak. The Lord had spoken to me about getting training to go in full-time ministry with Native people. My dad was Cherokee. My mother was Irish.
That's an interesting combination.
Yes, it is.
How did you survive that combination?
Very fiery. I met him in Canada at a training for... working with Native families, and he was one of the trainers there. We exchanged business cards, and then a few months later, he needed a counselor. Canada was holding one of the tribes, was Skagenish up in northern Quebec, was holding the first ever residential healing conference for the boarding schools that Native people had been in. And so he needed a woman counselor to work that understood trauma and domestic violence and sexual assault and things like that. And that's what I do.
That's what you do.
So they flew me up, and we worked together for a week. And it was challenging, but we decided, well, maybe God's doing something here, you know, with the two of us. So we spent the next year and a half or so, mostly by phone, but periodically every 3 months, they would call and want me to come back up. And, you know, so we never really dated. Our togetherness, so to speak, was in the ministry in these places, and it was kind of protected. And then after a while, our phone calls got so expensive, we decided we either needed to not talk anymore or we needed to get married. So,
well, that is very interesting. Now, Ivan, you have a Native American background, probably stronger than Linda's.
Yes, he does.
Yes. The last time I checked, it was like 99.0%.
That's pretty strong.
That's at least that's what the chief of our tribe said when I asked for my blood level. No, I'm from the Oneida Nation of the Iroquois Confederacy, and originally we had five nations: the Mohawk, the Oneida, the Onondaga, the Cougar, and the Seneca, that were separate tribes, but then came together around 1150, and they formed an alliance, where they had this covenant that they agreed together. It's called the Gayansagoa, which outlines how they should function together as a tribe. It outlines, you know, the different roles of the chiefs and the clan mothers and so forth. So anyway, that's my background. I was born and raised in my community. I lived there for 10 years, and then my dad moved me stateside to Buffalo.
So you live in a reservation?
Yes, ma'am.
What was that like?
To be honest with you, you know, when you're a kid, I was there for 10 years. I really didn't notice the difference. I mean, to me, this was just normal. But
you didn't live in teepees.
No, did not live in teepees. No, we lived in. I lived with my grandmother, my grandparents, and you know, they had a nice home and everything, and they provided for us. Mm-hmm. And most people don't that part. You know, the whole teepee thing is the Plains tribe, more up in our area. Our people call ourselves the Haudenosaunee, which is the people of the longhouse, and that our ancient people, they would build these birch bark longhouses that their whole family units could live in.
Oh.
And so that's where they got their name. So,
and that name again is what?
The Haudenosaunee.
Haudenosaunee, how interesting.
That means people of the longhouse in the language.
People in the longhouse. So it's very interesting. You got married and you came to St. Louis. You came to St. Louis, but there's no reservations here. Why did you choose St. Louis? Or is the previous story needing to be told before you tell that story?
Well, the reality is, when I met my wife, and you know, she thought she was going to move to New York, where I was living at the time.
Okay.
But the Lord spoke to her, and you know, and I prayed about it, and basically could say I moved to St. Louis because I was in love, and you know, this was a woman that I was going to marry, and this is where I also the Lord had spoken to me a number of years before that I was going to be moving west. And so I knew ahead of time it was going to be, just didn't know when, you know. So, but then when I moved to St. Louis, I didn't know, you know, how far west. I said, continue to pray and ask the Lord, you know, how, you know, where that was anyway. So, when I did get here, yes, there's not a large Native population here. However, they say there's 3,300 Native American people in the St. Louis region.
3,300 in St. Louis area.
Yes.
In the greater St. Louis area.
Yes, the greater St. Louis area.
Okay.
And but they're embedded in the environment, you know, in the urban society, and you don't usually see them come out unless there's some type of festival or event that's Native oriented, and then they begin to show up.
3,300 Native Americans living in the greater St. Louis America. Maybe you are a Native American and you're thinking, this is so interesting. Well, keep listening, because we are going to talk about more things that you can identify with. And if you're not Native American, you will get a great education like I'm getting as you listen to Good News with Judy and Imani. So you guys started your ministry here. And Ivan, tell a little bit about your educational background. Now, you each have 1 minute to tell about your educational background.
Well, I dropped out of high school when I was 16 to play in a rock band. And after God had come to know the Lord, I went back to school and I got my GED. Then I got my, I went to Bible college for 3 years. And then I went to Roberts Wesleyan and got my bachelor's in psychology. And then I went to Washington University where I got a master's degree in social work.
Wow, that's a switch from being 16 and dropping out of high school. So if you are in that state, or your kids are, and they're thinking about dropping out of high school, encourage them by telling them Ivan's story, how God could use a young man who really didn't know where his life was going, and now today make him a leader in not only the greater St. Louis area, but in our nation. And how about you, Linda?
I did my bachelor's at Stony Brook University in Long Island, New York, and then went on to do my master's in forensic psychology at John Jay College of Criminal Justice. Then I was hired to come, there was a lot of jobs I was doing there, disaster related. And then University of Missouri hired me to come back here after the flood wall broke when everything burst in 93. And I was hired as the disaster team coordinator for University of Missouri for the flood project. Then Warshu hired me. But in the meantime, the Lord spoke to me about finishing up my doctorate, and so I did my doctorate in counseling and family therapy at St. Louis University. So my area of interest, expertise, is trauma related, working with disaster survivors, the survivors of domestic abuse, sexual abuse, things like that.
So she has an event coming up on the 20th of July. If some of you want more information about what she does with trauma and everything, tell us about that, Linda.
Well, the Lord really, I've always worked with domestic violence, women and children, but especially women, helping them escape their situations, helping them bring healing. But about a year ago, the Lord really dropped it in my spirit to develop a program, an initiative. I call it the Women's Restoration Initiative, where I feel very strongly we need to connect, network across our region, the Heartland, and across the nation. And so many pieces need to come together. I'm willing to come in if you've got groups that want to be trained. My husband trains on the predator victim spirit. We do a lot of training on these aspects. Understanding trauma survival, domestic violence, the abusers, but we need to bring together lawyers that are willing to do pro bono work. These women, most of them are broke when they come into the system. Working with women need to be equipped to be advocates, to walk with these women and help them do expertise, court situations. We need drivers, security drivers, men that are willing to be trained and escort us to court. So there's a lot of pieces. So the July 20th meeting from 10 to 12 is at Life Church, 8134 Mexico Road in St. Peter's. It's an informational meeting. It's not a conference. There's no fee or anything. I just want those that are interested or that want to be involved or already involved, come, let's talk about, I'll do some stats, I'll do a little bit of training, teaching on the stats, but mostly it's informational for those of you that are interested how you can be involved. Missouri is number three. It was number one in homicide and domestic violence. It is number three. Kentucky, Nevada, and Missouri. And that deviates. Missouri was number one and two up until this year. So we're number three in domestic violence. That's horrific. And we need to address that. And how can we work together? And all my clients are in the church, by the way.
And what's a phone number or what's an email they can contact you?
My phone number is 636-399-7537. You can email me at lynndoxtator@gmail.com. That's Lynn, L-I-N-D-O.
Is this on your website? Do you have any of this on your website?
On the website, yes, the email would be different, but yes, you can go on the website.
Hold on. Is this event listed on your website?
No, I don't. No, that is not listed on the website.
Okay. So for more information, Lynn, on this event, how can they contact you?
The best way would be to call me 636-399-7537.
And that's 636-399-7537. Ivan and Linda Doxtator are my guests right here on Good News with Judy and Imani, founders and directors, First Nation Restoration Ministry. We'll be right back after this break. This is Good News with Judy and Imani. I'm Judy Redlich. This is Good News with Judy and Imani. Imani will be back next time. But we have Ivan and Linda Doxtator in our studio today, and they are with First Nations Ministry. They are from First Nations Restoration. And we're talking about the Native American population. There are 3,300 Native Americans in the greater St. Louis area. And how many did you say, Ivan, U.S.-wide?
There's, population-wise, there's probably about 4 to 5 million. In the United States and Canada. Here in the United States, there's about 365 tribes across the United States.
So they work with First Nations Restoration Ministry. They founded it. It's a Christian organization. And Ivan, heart cry is one of the major things that you do. Tell us about that.
Okay, to fully get a grasp on heart cry, you know, people need to understand that St. Louis has a history that goes back, you know, to the original people that were here with the Cahokian Mississippian culture that goes back over
the Cahokia Mounds.
Yes, over 1,300 years. And there was once a native population here of well over 30,000. And when that community went into demise, the tribes went up the river systems and into, you know, the plains and so forth through Missouri River. Most of those tribes are Sioux and language group people. Okay, so in 2005, the Lord has told us to once again gather Native people to the heart of the nation, because it was always His desire that Native people would worship Him from the heart and to steward it and to keep it spiritually clean and to build a worship training and outreach center here. So that was the assignment. You know, and early I talked about, you know, moving here to the St. Louis region, but actually I was a part of that was a journey to find out my assigned territory. Mm-hmm. So that's when God let me know that this was my assigned territory. And I believe when you're assigned a territory, that's where you have the greatest influence and the greatest authority. So, you know, so out of that, in 2017, we were praying with our intercessors about St. Louis. We, you know, it says, out of the heart come the issues of life. And we were seeing some very negative things coming out of the heart, being birthed out of the heart that were influencing the nation. So I was praying, we were praying and asking Lord, what should we do? And Lord spoke and said, invite me into the heart of the nation and dedicate it to me and watch what I will do. So to activate that word, we then mobilized four prayer teams in the four directions around the St. Louis region, a 50-mile radius, which we call the Heartland Prayer Council. Mm. And these groups meet to confer together how to strategically pray for the region targeting those situations or areas where we think troubling spiritually is affecting the St. Louis region. So one of our targets was Ferguson because of what happened there in 2014, and we mobilized a prayer team there that are currently stewarding it and praying over that area continuously for God to be there. One of our major focuses with the ministry is what we call community transformation, where we believe that God can come in such a way as he can totally change a community economically, socioeconomic situations are transformed for God to be blessed, people are saved, all these things. Okay, so it's about really bringing your community to Christ and that influence spilling over into the community. So what we do is we work developing transformation strategies with the groups that we work with here in St. Louis. So Heart Cry is about bringing those groups together along with Native American people, bringing them back to the heart of the nation to mobilize prayer, understand how to be strategic. You know, we believe that God is raising up an apostolic people to carry out his mission here, because out of the heart comes the issues of life. We believe that St. Louis or this heartland area, God ordained it to be a place from which, you know, the word of God would be released, prophetic words would be released, prayers would be released that would affect the nation. So Heart Cry is about gathering people together, the body of Christ together here in the heartland, to begin to cry out from the heart and ask God to save and heal our nation, save and heal these different dimensions, states, people groups, and so forth. So that's what Heart Cry is really about. Now this year we're having Heart Cry September 19th, 20th, and 21st in St. Peter's at Life Church.
Life Church, and that's located?
That's located on Mexico Road in St. Peter's.
8134 Mexico Road, St. Peter's.
8134 Mexico Road in St. Peter's. And that's Heart Cry. And that's also where that women's conference we talked about in the first segment of this show is going to be located. So if you're interested in either one of those, you can contact this phone number, 636-399-7537. And what is your website?
It's firstnationsrestoration.org.
firstnationsrestoration.org. All right, so Ivan, continue.
Okay, so part of the significance is that, you know, the Native people were the original people of the land. God says he's appointed the ancient people. Although we come from Adam, he says God has predetermined our boundaries and our dwelling places. You can see this in Scripture. And the Lord says the heavens belong to the Lord, but the earth he has given to the children of men. So God has assigned different people groups to steward and gatekeep certain areas around the world, basically. So when the Tower of Babel occurred and the people were dispersed, you know, to the different continents, each one of those people groups, when the continents they went to, they became what we call the host people. And, you know, that was their territory, and they were to guard it and keep it. Just like Adam in the garden, God says, keep it. You know, so that Adam was the original gatekeeper. He was the first apostle that had a territory that he was to keep. But the enemy infiltrated it, contaminated it, and brought it into captivity. So what we're saying here is the Native people, the Native American people, have a dimension of authority because they're the host people, that they can open and close gates that other people cannot. Spiritually. So the Native people were there. They were the gatekeepers that invited in many of these ancient spirits that are dominating the continent right now, and they're the ones that have to come in and close those gates. So we work with tribes to initiate this process. It's part of seeing God come and seeing the community transformation initiative fulfilled.
When is Heart Cry, and what topics will you be covering in that?
Heart Cry is September 19th, 20th, and 21st. It starts on a Thursday. A Thursday we have training all day and workshops for people to understand prophetic prayer and prayer work. And then Friday we have, which is a praise and worship day, where we cry out to God from the heart. And then Saturday we wrap up with one of our business people talking about marketplace ministry. So what we do is in the workshops is we talk about issues like prophetic intercession. What does that mean? We talk about, okay, communities that have been transformed. We're having speakers come in that we have one speaker, Ruth Reibel, that's coming in. That's her community in Cali, Colombia has been in transformation for 30 years now. And she has so much experience and so much to share about the challenges of that dimension. Then we have a pastor coming in that works with our network that is seeing changes happen in his community in Pennsylvania. Then we have a Native American pastor that's coming in that's doing the same type of work in among the Blackfoot Nation people up in northern Montana and southern Alberta. So we'll be having, then we'll also have some local people here. We work with individuals like, I don't know if you know Eric Ross. We work with him in developing these the outreach models, mechanisms that will influence the community for the Lord. So we do the prayer work, they do the outreach, then we have teams doing follow-up to continue to bring in the harvest.
Tell us a story of God's power in some of the heart cries of the past.
God's power, the first one we had was in 2019. We had 14 different Native American representatives come in, and the key that we see is repentance. You know, God says, if my people will humble themselves, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven, I will forgive them, and I will heal their land. God wants the land to be healed. The Bible says the earth groans waiting for the manifestations of the sons of God. And it also says the land mourns and no one takes it to heart. So, you know, part of what we see happening is God touching neighborhoods and touching people, you know, when we pray there. Because basically, you know, we clean up the atmosphere spiritually so things can happen. So with Heart Cry in 2019, we had a tremendous outpouring of the Spirit of God on the last night of worship, and it was so profound. It's the most intensive presence of the Lord that I've experienced in my life as a believer, and that's almost over 44 years now. And we just saw God doing healings. We saw God just touching people in such a way that they were overwhelmed by the presence of the Lord.
Wow. Heart Cry Conference coming up. Founders and directors of First Nations Restoration Ministry. If you want more information, your website again?
FirstNationsRestoration.org.
FirstNationsRestoration.org. That's FirstNationsRestoration.org. Ivan and Linda Doxtator have been my guests today. Thank you so much for coming and opening our eyes to what's happening with our Native American brothers and sisters. This is Good News with Judy Imani. Thanks for watching.